Welcome everyone to the second day of Cutting Edge Collage in Britain, 1945 to now. I can just see the participant numbers climbing up. So make yourself at home, and you probably are at home anyway. Get a cup of tea, get lunch, and we'll just wait another second or two just to make sure that people are logging in okay. And then we'll begin formally with this session. So it's great, we already have over 70 people with us. It's fantastic that so many people can join us for this session. Okay, well, I think I will make a start because we've got a lot to fit in to 2 hours. My name is Sarah Turner. I'm the Deputy Director at the Paul Mellon Centre for Studies in British Art. And welcome back if you joined us yesterday for the first session of the conference. And to those of you who are joining us for the first time, a special welcome to this session on cuts, copies, clips, and the curatorial. Got all the C's there. This session is going to be full of ideas, innovative research and experimental thinking. And it's a great pleasure to welcome all our speakers who have joined us for this panel, as well as our chairs. Before we get any further, I'm just going to run you through the housekeeping rules and guidelines that we have for the Paul Mellon Centre webinars. So this session will consist of 2 panels. Each comprises of 2 15-minute papers, and there will be a Q&A session. That's where we rely on you, the audience, to engage with us and the ideas that you've heard in the presentations. And we ask you to put your questions into the Q&A function, and you find that at the bottom of your screen. We also like to have lots of chat during the sessions. Please use the chat box to get in touch with us. Danny, our events assistant, hosts that. And I'm also here with Shauna Blanchfield, our events manager. If you've got any questions about the session, any feedback, any ideas you want to contribute from the floor of the conference, as it were, please do pop that in the chat box as well. We'll have a multi-panel discussion at the end of the session, so there'll hopefully be plenty of time for conversation. The session will be recorded and it'll be made available afterwards via the Paul Mellon website, and you can find lots of recordings of our previous events, including the one yesterday. And so if you can't join for particular sessions of the conference, please look back onto the recordings page of the Paul Mellon website and you can catch up later on. We've also got closed captioning available for this session. Click the CC button at the bottom of the webinar screen and you can enable captions. And they are an amazing collage in their own right. Without further ado, I'm going to introduce our chair for this session, who is Professor Lynn Nead. And she is in the History of Art Department at Birkbeck, University of London. She's published widely on a range of art historical subjects, particularly the history of British visual culture in the 19th and 20th century. And her most recent book is The Tiger in the Smoke, Art and Culture in Post-War Britain. And we were delighted to publish that via the Paul Mellon Centre. So Lynn, I'm going to hand over to you now to introduce the 2 speakers who are forming the first part of this panel. Thanks so much.
Thanks very much, Sarah, and welcome to everyone. Wonderful numbers who are participating in this online event. So as Sarah said, this is the first panel in this kind of group of events around collage. And I think we should take a moment to admire the alliteration of cuts, copies, clips, and the curatorial, which explores the ways in which collage can be used to unsettle disciplines and media and materials. What I'm going to do is introduce our 2 speakers, first of all. They will both present, one after the other, 15-minute papers, and then we'll have time for questions for both papers from you and perhaps from me. So our first speaker is Ben Cranfield, and I can see that Ben has managed to finish his teaching and get here now. And he is a senior tutor on the curatorial theory and history course at the Royal College of Arts. And his paper is called Fragmenting the Contemporary, the Queer Timeliness of Collage and the Curatorial in Postwar Britain. So Ben is, as I've said, at the Royal College of Art. His research is focused on the relationship of the curatorial to notions of the contemporary and the archive, asking what it is to be with one's time. And this stems from his ongoing work into the history of art institutions, the theory of archives, and shifting ideas of art and culture in post-war Britain. And some of his recent articles include on not being with time queerly in post-war Britain, which was published in Performance Research in 2018, Mind the Gap, Unfolding the Proximities of the Curatorial, which was also published in Performance Research, All Play and No Work, A Ludistry. These are difficult titles to speak, Ben, of the curatorial as transitional objects at the early ICA, which was published in Tate Papers. And there are many others around this little sort of hub of themes that Ben works on. And in 2007 and 2008, he curated the year-long series 60 Years of Curating at London's ICA. So I'm going to hand over to you now, Ben, and we look forward to hearing your paper.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Lynn. Can you hear me? Is my sound okay?
Yes, we can hear you good. Thanks, Ben.
Great. And I'm just going to share my screen, and I'm very sorry for those ridiculously complicated paper titles. There's another one to entertain you with. So in 1954, Lawrence Alloway curated the exhibition Collages and Objects at the Institute of Contemporary Arts in London. More than just a museological overview of the relation between pre-war surrealist and post-war collage, the exhibition showed signs of another continued preoccupation of pre-war surrealism that had migrated into post-war Britain via the ICA, a concern with the mechanisms of display and presentation, the apparatus of the curatorial. In the pamphlet scattered throughout the conventional list of artworks on display were a series of quotes from the exhibiting artists on collage, eschewing a simpler exhibition narrative of historical progression for a collage of textual fragments. The exhibition itself was a designed environment created by exhibiting artist John McHale, who would be one of the three collagists in the ICA 1957 exhibition of that name. The curatorial, as a practice of presenting fragmented spaces of not quite connections, worked in dialogue with the overlaps, cuts, and jarring juxtapositions of collage to extend the picture plane towards a wider cultural sphere. Collage brought into the early ICA a set of unresolved tensions and problematics. Were the surrealist modes of montage and collage, performed by those who took pictures by day for the very publications they cut up at night, a critical undoing or a furtherance of the burgeoning consumer culture? More troubling still, were the decontextualized mashups of images of objects and people from ethnographic collections and magazines that they utilized a challenge to forms of colonial extraction or a furtherance of the exploitative regime that made such images available? As Lauren Walden has shown, although ostensibly anti-colonial, pre-war European surrealists exhibited more than just a fascination with the decontextualized images and objects of colonial ethnographic collections. And as Lisa Madigan Newby has argued, far from solving this antinomy between critical visual culture and fetishistic extraction appropriation, the post-war ICA continued both the avant-gardist move to destabilize regimes of cultural value whilst reinvesting in colonial essentializing discourses of primitivism. Although collage created a direct link between pre-war European modernism and the post-war ICA, the ICA as a conceptual as well as historical space did inflect these pre-war concerns in particular ways through the question that its titular formation begged: how to be contemporary? That is, how to be with or not with one's time. This question, never formally posed or answered, became a kind of lurking anxiety that haunted the early discussions at the ICA. In one such discussion, Sir Philip Hendy, then director of the National Gallery, commented that he had encountered a janitor's cupboard on his way to the talk held at the newly minted Arts Council's premises. He noted that he'd found, quote, the walls covered with pinups, and he went on to muse that, quote, it was interesting to discover that the one permanent representative of the Arts Council on their premises had to have his own private gallery, and that was perhaps symbolic of art in democracy. Hendy's aside reflected a growing crisis in post-war Britain around the idea of culture. This crisis is best captured, perhaps, by Raymond Williams' 1958 text, Culture is Ordinary. Williams ends the essay by asserting that his lived experience amongst friends and family taught him that he couldn't accept the notion that ordinary people were dupes of a cultural industry, just as much as he couldn't accept that culture of any sort had to be given to people as something exceptional that they lacked. As Williams was developing his questions concerning a redefinition of a materialist understanding of culture, the loose network of practitioners circulating around the ICA, who are usually referred to as the independent group, were in different and various ways challenging some of the essentialisms of the previous generation. Here, collage worked hand in hand with its counterpart, the curatorial. Whilst the former was concerned with turning the fragmenting, collecting, and extracting gaze of the ethnographer onto the forms of Western capitalist production to produce hyper-composite images that mocked and venerated the source material it redeployed, the latter, the curatorial, assembled ready-made images as much to perform a Brechtian exposure of the mechanisms of cultural display as to exploit those mechanisms to produce a decidedly post-humanist and anti-museological exhibitionary position. For example, as Ben Highmore has noted, the pamphlet accompanying the exhibition, the 1953 exhibition, Parallel of Life and Art, played with the conventions of categorization to destabilize not just art, non-art distinctions, but the very indexical and evidentiary assumptions of photography. I would claim that Parallel knowingly and importantly undid many of the categorical assumptions that attended the ICA's more ethnographically minded displays, such as the exhibition Wonder and Horror of the Human Head in the same year. However, there is also evident in Parallel a sheer acritical pleasure in the possibilities of technological reproduction to produce homologies and seductive juxtapositions that feeds into a wider sense of unresolved ambivalence that has been frequently noted in the work of the IG, brutalism, and pop art more broadly, namely whether the work should be read as a critical engagement with or exuberant take-up of contemporary mass-produced culture and its attendant technologies. I would suggest that this question can be usefully recast in the light of the ICA's uncertain mandate as a concern about being in or with time. In the 1964 issue of the ICA's short-lived Living Arts magazine, Reyner Banham published his own essay on timeliness, the atavism of the short-distance mini-cyclist. Musing on the moment of the Cold War and the shared sensibility amongst those advocates of taking popular culture seriously, he noted that, quote, suddenly there came a moment when it was very difficult to read Time or any American magazine at all, simply because of one's political loyalties. In that period, there arose a situation where one's natural leanings in the world of entertainment and so on were to the States, but one's political philosophy seemed to require one to turn one's back on the States, end quote. The possibility of enjoying that which was at odds with one's politics or perhaps with one's class, gender, or background put light to the notion that identity might be considered singular and constructed through a predetermined set of signifiers that were located in time and place. This posed a problem for both the avant-gardist assumptions of the ICA's founding modernists, as much as it did Hogarthian cultural studies, and the emerging marketeers of a state-backed Britain can make it consumption. What if people's relationship to culture was collagic and contradictory rather than causal? The efforts of public exhibitions such as Britain Can Make It, the Festival of Britain, and perhaps the quirkiest At Home with Bill and Betty, attempted to straighten out any such relationship between culture, lifestyle, and productive consumption within the demands of a post-war state-sponsored capitalism. The notion of the contemporary thus deployed in such context was about aligning a general public with the requirements of post-war reconstruction and the aspirant values of emergent consumer capitalism. Richard Hamilton's scathing response to the Council of Industrial Design and Festival of Britain's form of contemporary design was that it was just a way of keeping out of date with American culture. Such a position suggests that perhaps arguably the most famous collage of the period, Just What Is It That Makes the Days So Home So Different So Appealing, produced by Hamilton with Terry O'Reilly, Magda Cordell, and John McHale, was little more than a straight homage to the more advanced consumer culture of America, expressing a desire not to be left behind in gray, rationed post-war Britain. However, as significant as the final image informing the collagic relationship to the contemporary was the practice that preceded its creation, the obsessive collecting of the detritus of mass media. Although reveling in the offer of contemporary media, the collagist as collector and archivist of the already fading present does not so much produce a semi-factive capturing of the now. It's not the decisive moment of photography. Rather, there is a dragging of the present. The scrapbook renders the fragments of the once contemporary a part of an expanding archive of the contemporary. Not so much an archive of a particular historic moment, but an exhaustive, of those exhaustive and exhausting attempts to be contemporary, to be in time. Such an archival practice, what Hal Foster called the independent group's pinboard aesthetic, reverses Foster's aphorism for archival art of the 2000s, that it turns belatedness into becomingness, and rather turns the perpetual becoming of the contemporary into a belatedness, an image bank of failures to lay claim to the present moment. Above, I use the word dragging specifically to invoke Elizabeth Freeman's notion of temporal drag, a queer out of timeliness that allows one to be simultaneously with and not with one's time, or closer still, to be part of one's time through an untimeliness, to be queerly with time. Drag here operates differently from nostalgia or historic pastiche. Drag is about retrogression, delay, and the pull of the past on the present. Dominic James reprises Jonathan Katz's argument that Just What Is It is queer in its hyperbolic recreation of Adam and Eve as bodybuilder and pinup. James also drags Just What Is It by creating a suggestive queer lineage between this pop collage and the scrapbooks of Cecil Beaton. James specifically understands Beaton's scrapbook to offer a reorientation of dominant heterosexualized images into queer configurations, the cut and overlap of collage interplaying with the not quite alignments of the gaps in the mechanism display. But James also employs the same process of reorientation by collaging Beaton next to Just What Is It to queer the latter with the former. Here, I think that José Esteban Muñoz's notion of disidentification is helpful. Muñoz asserts that disidentification is about, quote, recycling and rethinking encoded meaning, but that it is, quote, a step further than cracking up the code of the majority. It proceeds to use this code as raw material for representing a disempowered politics or positionality that has been rendered unthinkable by the dominant culture. such a disidentified reading, I think can also be applied to the image that Hamilton produced with Richard Freeman for the second issue of Living Arts magazine. When I first discovered that Hamilton had latterly called this piece self-portrait, I got a queer thrill. Part pin-up, part footballer, part machine, part space-age pod. How queer could a self-portrait be? I was somewhat deflated when I learned that it was Hamilton in the footballer's drag, perhaps surrounded by his hyper-masculine phallic desiderata. However, I think my disidentified reading is closer to the potential of that image. Indeed, how can an image taken by Freeman and styled by Betsy Sherman be a self-portrait? The Hamilton-Freeman-Sherman collaboration offers a collagic understanding of the contemporary self, that is, the desiring subject dispersed in the archive of the now. Emboldened by James and Munoz, I think that this image can be disidentified and collaged into an archive of queer untimeliness. In doing so, it allows an easy connection with the work of another debutant of the ICA in the 1950s, Kenneth Anger. Anger was explicitly engaged with Hollywood as a system of representation to be fragmented through consumptive desire on the one hand and undone through the exaggerated collagic interplay of those fragments into utterly un-Hollywood cinematic work on the other. Anger's occulting of glamour throws into relief the whole normative framework of assumptions that preceded Williams' cultural equation. What Anger's work centers is a different kind of looking to that of formal criticism or anthropological analysis, looking through the framework of disidentificatory desire. In particular, Anger's early shorts, Fireworks, and Puce Moment fragment the iconography of Hollywood to resemble scenes of queer relationality. A performance of a fragmented and contradictory identitarian position, and at the same time, a disidentificatory framework that remakes the normative idea of fandom that was very much part of British pop art collage into a queer practice of untimely obsession. Fireworks is a direct queer self-portrait of Anger, featuring as it does Anger in the lead role in a violent confrontation with Hollywood tropes of masculinity. However, Puce is a queer use of film as a temporal medium, a fragment of a film project, Puce Women, that was never to be completed. It appears also as a snippet of a home movie crossed with a screen test, existing outside before and after cinema proper. Puce is less an explicit investigation of queerness than itself what Melissa Hardy calls a pliant queer object, an object that she says, quote, proliferates rather than thwarts, aligns rather than disturbs, impresses rather than inhibits. The pliant queer objects that Melissa Hardy analyzes are the unsanctioned book collages made by Kenneth Halliwell and Joe Orton from borrowed books from the Islington Library. Started in the same year, the year after Collages and Objects at the ICA in 1955. Whilst Puce made public a private moment of infatuation with the already outmoded glamour of a Hollywood of a different era, Halliwell and Orton's queer objects took the public resource of the library and turned them into a private museum, whilst reveling in the frisson caused by reinserting private acts of collagic play back into public circulation, turning the janitor's cupboard loose. In both Puce and the library book collages, queerness comes not primarily from the sexual dissidence of their makers, but from their uncertain ephemeral quality, the way they form a parasitic relationship with the main frames of culture. It's also not insignificant that Halliwell and Orton's primary pleasure was in peering through the book stacks to see the shock and pleasure that their collages produced, mirroring, like the furtive glances of Puce, the practice of cruising. For Munoz, cruising isn't just a sexual practice, but a strategy for producing queer affinities across time and space, a way of knowing outside of the evidential forms of historicization. Indeed, there is something in the labyrinth of the exhibition display and the overlaps of collage that invites such films of non-linear looking, the peek around the corner, the backward glance. Such is the case with another pliant queer object produced in post-war Britain. The July 1964 edition of Jeff Nuttall's My Own Mag, a publication that tips from avant-gardist magazine to punk queer zine, is cut up and recollaged into mini booklets that can be read like a checkerboard to produce new collagic texts. Here the reader is invited to peel back the front cover and peer into the glory holes of the publication. This metaphorical cruising reveals a scene of actual cruising, with an extract from Small Creep's Day by Peter Currell Brown, in which the eponymous Small Creep attempts to have sex with a prostitute in a public toilet, only to find an orgy of gay public sex taking place. Currell, who was an ardent anti-nuclear campaigner, confronted the dystopia of nuclear end time with the small-minded Small Creep, who has extracted himself from regulated work time, only to find himself in a collage of scenes that confound his sensibilities as a respectable citizen. What Small Creep couldn't handle was the vicissitudes of what in an ICA exhibition in 1963, the organizers, some of whom became better known as Archigram, called the Living City. The ICA's most collagic exhibition yet, as Simon Sadler argues, Living City channeled a Baudelairean taste for the contingent and ephemeral, in opposition to the planned modernist city. Edition 3 of Living Arts magazine operated as a catalogue for the exhibition. However, rather than a straight space of documentation, the magazine issue provided a diverse range of images and media, predominantly collage, to invoke an anti-architectural sensibility. At the centre of this was the Living City Survival Kit. Simon Sadler directly relates the survival kit to the Hamilton Freeman Sherman collaboration, arguing that it was, quote, at some level, the self-portrait of a young man, end quote. Indeed, there is something distinctly heterosexist in Living City's homage to the flaneur of the post-war consumer city. I wouldn't want to refute this reading, but I do see in the kit a queerer potential. Again, as with Just What Is It?, there is an ambiguity about the lipstick and the gun, the washing powder and the playboy that allows for an eschewing of a straight reading of the gendered tropes that are invoked. Indeed, not being a collaged image, but more of a curatorial display of objects, it turns an anthropological gaze into a queer way, in a queer way, back on the consumptive habits of its living citizens. There is one final way I would disidentify this image, the survival kit, to conclude this collage of post-war contemporary. The most striking thing to me about survival kit is that one object appears three times. John Coltrane's 1962 album, Coltrane. Actually, this should not be surprising. As Jeff Nuttall noted in his book, Bomb Culture, jazz was the ground zero of Western post-war counterculture. But the triplicate also underlines absence and disavowal, the failure in canonical Western histories and institutions of modernism to acknowledge the centrality and vital importance of Black music and artists to modernist thought and practice. Thinking of this absence and presence, the final queer leap I want to make is to John Acomfra's collagic portrait of Stuart Hall in the Stuart Hall Project, 2013. Hall, who did more than anyone else in post-war Britain to take on the challenge of rethinking William's cultural equation, specifically challenged an idea of fixed cultural identity and assumed cultural value. Acomfra takes this position and manifests it through the use of collage and montage to produce a pluralistic portrait that defies the traps of categorical capture. Hauntingly, throughout the film, Hall's personal cultural touchstone, the music of Miles Davis, plays, dragging out a different tempo to the frenetic ones of post-war and post-colonial upheaval. Hall, via Acomfra, inflected through a queer post-war archive of collagic practice, seems to say that collage may not be just an act of consumption or analysis, but a practice of surviving in and despite the regimes of timeliness that would claim to already know us. Thank you very much.
And thank you very much indeed. There's so much in that paper, so I'm sure we'll pull out some of those things when we get to the questions. But what I want to do now is introduce our second speaker, who is Craig Buckley, who is an Associate Professor of Modern and Contemporary Architecture in the Department of History of Art at Yale University. He is the author most recently of a book called Graphic Assembly, Montage, Media and Experimental Architecture in the 1960s, which was published in 2019 by the University of Minnesota Press. He's published many essays that have appeared in journals such as Grey Room, October, Log and Perspecta, among others. And he's the editor of numerous collections, including Screen Genealogies, From Optical Device to Environmental Medium, and After the Manifesto, Writing, Architecture and Media in a New Century. And he's currently working on a new book with the title The Street and the Screen, a media archaeology of the architectures of the moving image in the 20th century, which sounds wonderful as well. So Craig, your paper is An Architecture of Clipping, Reyner, Banham and the Redefinition of Collage. And I'll hand over to you and your screen.
Great. Can you hear me? Can everybody hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Thank yes.
Great. Okay. Thank you, Lynn, for that introduction. Thank you to Rosie and Elena and Sarah for organizing the conference and pulling it together after all of the roadblocks of the last year. And of course, to Shauna for all of her behind the scenes work to make this all move so smoothly. Let me see if I can share my screen here. For whatever reason, I don't see my PowerPoint. Hang on a second. Okay, share screen. Where did my PowerPoint go? Oh, it worked earlier.
Craig, are you having difficulties sharing screen?
Yeah, I...
Perhaps we could have some assistance with that, Danny?
Yeah.
I have a copy of Craig's PowerPoint. Just give me one moment.
Could you put it on? I don't know why my PowerPoint has disappeared from the sharing options here.
Yeah, absolutely.
We should be able to get, there we are.
Great, okay, so I'll just say slide and you can maybe advance it from your end.
Mm-hmm.
Great. If you could put up the first slide, thank you. So in 1965, the historian and critic Reyner Banham published his theory of clip-on architecture in the magazine Design Quarterly. The issue arrived emblazoned with a photo collage of Walking City on its cover, a speculative project by Ron Heron of the Archigram Group for a lumbering space-age mobile city capable of roaming the planet. In defining the new term, Banham looked to grasp changes in architectural culture that had arisen in conversation with British pop art since the 1950s, an architecture that he described as bright and mechanistic in spirit, but also averse to durably fused connections and enamored with kits of interchangeable industrial parts. A theory developed to describe the work of architects like Cedric Price and the members of the Archigram Group, it would also come to inspire a slightly younger generation, including Sue and Richard Rogers, Norman Foster, and Renzo Piano. If you could put up the next slide, please. There's some examples. The clip in Banham's clip-on architecture was an industrial fastener of the kinds used to attach industrial cladding systems or to affix the new compact portable engines of the 1960s, such as the outboard motor. In emphasizing such impermanent attachments, clip-on architecture described a different ethos of assembly, summed up by Banham as, quote, an architecture of indeterminate form assembled from expendable components. Today, I want to revisit Banham's term and suggest how it might be interpreted from a different angle. If clipping described indeterminate connections between expendable industrial parts, it had also long been a term used for the cutting out and collecting of printed information. In this double meaning, a different history of collecting paper and a different division of intellectual labor around paperwork, I think, can be located. This double meaning points to a distinct and not quite recognized historical terrain from which to reassess the central place of collage, the central place that collage has long enjoyed in accounts of post-war British architecture that emerged in the wake of the independent group. Introducing a notion of clipping concerns less a question of style than the procedures involved in making these works. If you can advance to the next slide, please. A logic of clipping, therefore, was distinct from the embrace of materials as found associated with the new brutalism of the Smithsons, Paolozzi, and others. But nor can clipping be assimilated to the contextualist idea of the city as a multi-layered historical field advanced by Colin Rowe and Fred Ketter's influential volume, Collage City, in the 1970s. Next slide, please. You see it there, published in 75 initially. So neither an embrace of raw materiality and informal composition, nor a reading of context based on figure ground analysis, clipping marked a reorientation of collage discourse toward the appropriation of information, technologies, and concepts that were crucially borrowed from fields adjacent to architecture. The making of scrapbooks and the collection of tear sheets and other printed matter has, as we've already seen wonderfully today, already been recognized as a hobby and practice of visual research essential to collage. Yet from the late 19th century onwards, clipping described something different from a scrapbook and something other than a pastime. It emerged as a major branch of clerical work. Next slide, please. The first clipping bureaus were established in Paris and London in the 1880s and rapidly spread around the world in the later 19th century and early 20th century. Initially a specialized service catering to artists, entertainers, and businesses that were eager to track mentions of themselves. Such organizations grew quickly into firms that tracked all kinds of different references across the widest spectrum of newspapers and magazines. Scholars of communication such as Anka T. Heesen and Richard Popp have argued that clipping bureaus treated the exploding domain of newspapers and magazines as a mine whose value could be extracted through rationalized procedures for reading, collecting, categorizing, and redistributing printed matter. Next slide, please. Reflective of the greater experimentation of clerical work at the end of the 19th century, clipping bureaus boasted of the extraordinary efficiency of their speed readers, almost invariably young women who entered the white-collar labor force in droves at the end of the 19th century. With their eyes trained to scan the equivalent of 3 novels worth of text every day, the women working in clipping bureaus searched magazines and newspapers for hundreds of memorized names and keywords. Typically, the scanner would underline a significant mention and set the marked paper aside for another worker who would cut out the relevant passages and paste them to a card. Yet another worker would file the notices in the extensive file catalogs maintained by the clipping bureaus. For Pop, clipping bureaus laid the foundation for contemporary data mining long before the so-called digital revolution, building a commercial infrastructure for extracting and reselling information from the daily flows of mass mediated communications. Clipping enabled the emergence of such things as mass market research and opinion gathering on a mass scale. Clipping in this sense is a distinct historical technique of cutting and collecting printed paper. As an organized process, clipping reminds one that information is not an inherent property of printed communication. Rather, it describes the value being derived from being able to identify and extract elements from a flow of media. Second, the value of clipping rests on a quasi-Taylorized and historically gendered division of labor, in which the routinized work of scanning, storing, and classifying formed the unrecognized basis for acts that sought to interpret, analyze, and capitalize on information. The question I wanted to ask is, to what extent did collage and post-war British architecture internalize aspects of this more regimented and informational process associated with clipping? And to return to this canonical example already seen once today, it's well known that the muscle men, pinups, appliances, gadgets, decorations, and comestibles that make up Hamilton's iconic collage were selected on the basis of keywords that were used to scan contemporary advertisements. There it's back. Great. Hamilton is credited with the collage because he assembled the cutout elements, but it was Terry Hamilton and Magda Cordell who did the clipping, scanning through the magazines that had been brought back to the UK by John McHale. Recognizing the division of labor that echoes the practices of the clipping bureau as internal to one of the central works of British Pop, I think could reopen questions of agency in relationship to such a work. And it might also inscribe that canonical image within a different history, one in which the emphasis on Pop iconography might be grasped not only as derived from art historical methodology, but as a practice of seeing informed by the extractive logic characteristic of these early information industries. if Hamilton's famous photo collage made use of the division of labor characteristic of clipping. Clipping also operated in complex tension with collage. More often than not, artists and architects were at once in the position of clippers and composers, scanners and reassemblers, routinized workers and consuming clients. John McHale, Hamilton's collaborator at This Is Tomorrow, was also an extensive clipper, maintaining a very large collection of tear sheets from the period's illustrated press. Next slide, please. There they are, that's just a small selection. McHale used these clipping files, and many of which are today at the Yale Center for British Art, to develop a theory of popular iconography during these years and for a series of collage works. For McHale, like his colleague Banham, iconography became something more than the analysis of the meaning of a figure within an established artistic or theological tradition. Next slide, please. Iconographic looking came to be informed by the dynamics of scanning, extraction, and reevaluation characteristic of clipping. In his 1959 article, The Expendable Icon, McHale theorized the icon as an image, quote, extracted from the media continuum, which was itself continually in flux. It was by being extracted that images of robots, rockets, computers, or movie stars enabled some purchase on the continually changing movements of mass culture. Indeed, McHale went so far as to argue that such media icons had taken over the role played by more permanent symbolic constructs from earlier periods, whether they be poems or totems, masks or cathedrals. For McHale, the rapid changes characteristic of a mass-mediated society could only be managed via clipping, the cutting and organizing of paper, providing the sense of orientation that, quote, enabled humans to locate themselves in and deal with their environment. Now, in McHale's early collages, we see, I think, an intimate relationship between scanning and reading. If we could go to the next slide. Collage, he wrote at the time, has parallels to our actual experience of the image as we turn the pages of a magazine or scan a newspaper. And if you could just click forward through some of these images, this is an early collage book from 55, just to give you a sense of it as a book. It's interesting to see the genre of the collage book in both presentations. McHale constructed these from commercial catalogs. Cutting, folding, and pasting the pages of a jeweler's catalog, he produced a work whose form was partly determined by the user. Turning pages and manipulating flaps were physical acts that produced a continually shifting visual field, creating and destroying bizarre collisions that altered the legibility of the underlying words and figures. On the one hand, such pages demanded that the eye operate in scanning mode, searching for familiarity in a field without any compositional stability. Faces sliced into strips are only recognizable based on partial gap-laden information. Yet if such an exercise inspired acts of optical retraining, the perceptual work they solicited troubled rather than reinforced, I think, automated reading and recognition. That is the sort of key ambivalence of these early collage books. In them, I want to suggest the ambivalent importance of practices of clipping and cataloging to collage come to the fore, anticipating how collage will come to be reconsidered in architectural discourse in the 1960s. This transformation was linked to another pivotal member of the IG, the South African-born architect and curator Theo Crosby, who became technical editor at the magazine Architectural Design in 1953. Next slide, please. Together with Monica Pidgeon, Crosby influentially remade a journal that was an offshoot of the Architects Standard Catalog Company, the main materials information service used by British architects to specify parts for construction. Crosby helped turn the magazine from a specialized trade journal, you see its cover there on the left from 1951, into a magazine with broader cultural ambition. Collage techniques were crucial to the covers which he designed each month, but even more remarkably, collage emerged as a key metaphor for conceptualizing the changing situation of the architect's intellectual work. Writing on the occasion of the 1961 International Union of Architects Congress in London, whose theme was, quote, an architecture of technology, Crosby highlighted how the conference's vision of technology implied an architecture assembled from industrial parts in which the architect had little, if any, role in designing. In such a situation, assembly could no longer remain a secondary question, a problem of, quote, mere building, but had to be understood as a question of design. Writing of the exhibition pavilion he designed for that year's Congress, he described how the architect was becoming, quote, a manipulator of prefabricated parts, his building a collage of bits and pieces. and he shows his inventiveness by taking some parts from technologies that are not his own. Next slide, please. Crosby's metaphor highlights a subtle yet important transformation in post-war collage discourse in architectural culture. For Crosby, inventiveness stemmed from repurposing such materials as industrialized space frame systems, typically used for warehouses. You see it there forming the roof structure, together with lightweight polyethylene sheeting and standard rough timber boards, all of which were covered with a supergraphic lettering design by Edward Wright. Next slide, please. Distinct from the earlier embrace of materials and situations as found, developed by the Smithsons and Palazzi, collage concerned here the manipulation of industrially prefabricated elements. Crucial was the ability to collect, manipulate, and recombine information gleaned from outside the field of architecture, underscoring collage as a practice that looked to step outside the increasingly systematized and consolidated product information that had been steadily monopolized by his very own employer, Ades publisher, the Standard Catalog Company. Inventiveness crucially lay neither within formal innovation nor with technical ingenuity, but rather in an ability to gather and appropriate knowledge from fields and domains that lay outside architecture's main material repertoire. It was in line with this sense of information and technology transfer that we might understand the centrality of clipping to an emerging generation of architects in the 1960s. For Banham, clip-on architecture was to bring architectural design into line with the most advanced forms of post-war production, a reorientation that meant abandoning architecture's aspiration to permanence in the hopes of working with the accelerated and changeable cycles of design, manufacture, consumption, and obsolescence that characterized advanced post-war industry. He championed a younger generation of architects, producing what he called protest magazines, such as Archigram and Clip Kit. If you can go to the next slide, please. Created using accessible photo offset lithographic technology, this younger generation made magazines by combining materials from their own clipping files on cardboard sheets to make paste-ups that the high street offset printers could then reproduce cheaply alongside supermarket flyers and other printed ephemera. Next slide, please. Peter Murray and Jeffrey Smythe's Clip Kit was not a bound magazine at all, but an open-ended clipping file, a monthly collection of offset printed sheets that compiled information on new technologies, materials, and projects gathered from a wide range of sources. Subscribers received the packets of unbound sheets in the mail and were to organize them together using their own clipping files by means of an extruded plastic binding. Next slide, please. You see it there on the right, a new device designed to manage the paper flow in post-war offices and factories. Banham glossed the title of Murray and Smythe's magazine for an older generation. Kit are usually ideas, images, forms, documents, and concepts rated from other disciplines, and clip is how you put them together to make intellectual or physical structures. His concern hinges notably less on the qualities of physical joints and connectors than on the processes of displacement and transposition, how the intellectual assets of other fields might be appropriated and recombined for architectural purposes. In his description, an important slippage occurs. A term for the routinized industrial cutting of mass-printed paper is here recast as a mode of experimental reattachment and recombination. Architectural agency is envisioned not as the masterful imposition of shape on raw materials, nor as the perfecting of elements that could become new industrial standards. Rather, it was the capacity to act on the flow of information, extracted by extracting and reassembling relationships among its short-lived elements. If the composite material sensibility associated with collage became a metaphor for this new type of intellectual work, less well recognized was its debt to the domain of the clipping bureau. If Banham's theory of clip-on architecture offered a different idea of architectural agency in the 1960s, it elided the hierarchical division of labor that had been crucial to information gathering and management since the 19th century. Such a disappearance was a key to the changing meaning of clipping, aligning the term with creative technological recombination, but eliding the routinized work of information scanning that this entailed. For this very reason, recovering clipping's ignored history might enable this enduring period concept to be read from a different angle. Thank you.
Craig, that was great. Thank you so much. And I wonder if, Ben, you would like to join Craig and I for some questions. And Craig, can we? Thank you both very much. I've been told by the organisers that we started a bit late and we're running a bit late, but we can have a good time, 15 minutes for questions, so that we can begin to tease out some of the ideas. I think the papers go together and also kind of contrast really interestingly, because what they seem to suggest together is the way that collage can kind of, Ben, I really like the idea of collage disturbing state-sponsored forms of cultural consumption and economic consumption, that idea of post-war Britain as very linear. And yet, Craig, with your paper, we're getting the idea of a different kind of history that comes out of the imposition of a kind of structure and of Taylorism and of office work. So I think that those two, you begin to see what a kind of rich medium and technique this is. But I just wanted to just take the sort of, chair's prerogative and ask you both to perhaps say a little bit more about two phrases that one each that you used, which were a little bit throwaway, and I wondered if you could say a little bit more about. So it's about looking, really. Ben, you used the phrase non-linear looking, which became part of a sort of spatiality of the backward glance and the peek round the corner. So I was sort of wondering if you could say more about that. And Craig, you then talked about a practice of seeing. That again was drawn from this rather interesting different history of clipping. And both of them seem to me to imply a kind of mobility of the eye. And if you can, I wondered, Ben, perhaps first, and then Craig, if you could just say a little bit more about those rather sort of tantalizing phrases that you used.
As Evelyn, attendant to the things that have not been fully unpacked, thank you. I just have to say that listening to Craig's so interesting, and it is really useful for me. I was skewing things, I guess, towards the idea of collage as something that could be that could produce kind of non-normative ways of thinking and looking, but I really wanted to counteract that in a way by saying that, there's nothing, I think, inherent within the collagic or within that fragmentation which is subversive. It is part of a dominant order, and I think Craig thinking there about the way in which we understand this as information, I think, is really, really important. And it made me think across that, and this is in relation to what you're picking up on, Lynn, that a lot of this is about a kind of the developing of an attention, kind of attention economy, and thinking about what is it, how are we being asked to kind of direct our attention? And I guess that's sort of what I mean. Obviously, I'm using the word linear because I'm trying to kind of evoke the idea of straightening and its kind of various meanings. And absolutely, collage and the curatorial together as dominant kind of media devices are not inherently not necessarily producing a queer forms of looking at all. And I think if we think about exhibition paths as a kind of way of literally, suggesting to people the way they should go and how their attention should be directed, this is all part of that. So what's particularly interesting to me, I guess, are those engagements with the very same devices and their possibilities, but to produce a kind of what we might say a sort of dissident form of looking. So looking otherwise, and the possibility I always think of, that you can walk an exhibition backwards, you can flick a magazine the wrong way, you can fold something and do something else. This is where one, in a very humble way, can start to kind of trouble those those things that are purposefully trying to direct our attention to reorder it in another way. And that's where I would say the kind of that's what I sort of mean by the non-linear there.
Thank you. Craig.
Yeah. Terrific. Yeah, I really appreciate the juxtaposition of the two papers. I think it's absolutely unexpected in the best possible way. And just to say a little bit more about the practice of seeing, I think one of the things I was trying to draw out is just this shift in the meaning of iconography within this milieu of the independent group at the end of the 1950s. On the one hand, you have figures like Banham, who is picking up that term through his own art historical training, circulating it through the IG. You have McHale's encounter with both art history, but also the legacy of the Bauhaus at Yale in the 1950s. And to think about that in relationship to a different practice of seeing, which is that of the sort of the scanner, the professional scanner, whose eye really cannot linger, but is trained to recognize certain memorized terms or certain terms that have already been pre-established. As part of a wage labor system under pretty important pressures. And to think about how those two almost antithetical practices somehow are brought together in the 1950s around this notion of the icon, which McHale develops in these articles with, published in Architectural Design at the end of the 1950s. And I think in some ways, the legacy of clipping is not always directly linked, although I think the clipping files of so many of these artists are themselves incredibly rich, if hard to interpret archives, that can be revisited through a different lens if we think about them in relationship to more systematized practices of, let's say, information management and the effort to extract value from information. I think that there's something about the collision of those two very different ways, very different practices of seeing in the late 1950s that's intriguing. I think one finds it in particularly in McHale's work.
I think that's right. And I think, I'm not quite sure how they would work together, but I think it would be really interesting to kind of explore this more. Mm. And it seems to me that they both shift looking towards a kind of spatiality and to, kind of collage as well and clipping as spatial and as sort mm-hmm. of multidimensional. So yeah, mm-hmm. I as I say, I can't quite sort of work it through, but it's
I would also just add that they are both focused on an imminent idea of archive and the idea that the archive becomes not just a kind of historic space, but becomes a kind of constantly updated and interacted with mechanism. And it's interesting to note that the clippings agencies were obviously being used a lot by places like the ICA, places that were non-museological, who had to track their value in a very, very different way from that of the collection. So they're having to track it through the archive of the clippings, I guess a lot like architecture practices would too, mm-hmm. to be able to kind of record and locate their value. But then of course that becomes another material that could be utilized. Anyway, yeah. That's,
yeah. Mm-hmm. We've got a couple of questions. One from Jasmine, which, this is really for Craig. Do you think that clipping still affects us today via the internet?
Yeah, I would say so. I would venture to say that the materiality of clipping today is obviously very, very different. But the idea that there is a type of value to be generated through a systematic surveillance of continually changing ephemeral mass media is at the basis of the internet today. While we don't have clipping bureaus operating the same way, they still do, today they're called media monitoring services. That idea of just continually monitoring the output of newspapers, magazines, and of course, web pages, blogs, what have you, mm-hmm. is the very basis of the economy of the internet in some respects. though I would say it's probably would have to be thought through the lens of advertising today more than through, let's say, the clipping bureaus of the 19th and 20th century. Mm. I think that is absolutely crucial to think about.
I think you refer to data mining, don't you?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
There's also a question about archives, really. Are there specific archives? This is from Abby, of the works mentioned. So you've been using different images, and where are those archives? Are there specific archives that you've been using?
Is that for me or for Ben?
No, I think it's for both of you, actually.
For both, okay. Ben, do you want to go first?
Oh, okay, that's perhaps. Well, mine is quite simple. Terms of a lot of the ICA references, I have worked closely with the ICA archive that's held at Tate, Tate Britain. And there was a list at the end of my presentation. I did a kind of full image credit list, which I was mindful of you weren't getting as I was going, but I thought if there was one place I could play a little bit with not the kind of formal requirements of attribution, it would be in a discussion of collage. And I think that is important. You know, I mean, it's very easy to put those kind of things together now because of the internet, but I'm doing exactly, I guess, you know, taking what's available, what you can easily search for as those, you know, as the principle, you know, as the principle of collage, and you do it with a irresponsibility as well. You do it with an irresponsibility to the original source material and the context. And it's sort of why I had hovering there the question around colonial extraction, because I think that with that removal of context and the removal perhaps of the scene of the archive as a place of legislation, you offer up a series of kind of perhaps quite playful opportunities, but there may be also a danger in that, in removing attribution and moving a sense of where things are from, and do we really know? And some of the works and artists that we've alluded to have fallen, you know, foul of that criticism of being too free and loose with their source material without thinking about actually where's this from and what's the politics of that. Sorry, it's a slightly complicated answer, but yes, the short one is the ICA archive at Tate.
Right, okay. more things we could say. Craig, you mentioned the McHale archive at Yale, didn't you?
Yeah, there's a group of clippings files that were donated to the Center for British Art by Magda Cordell McHale, I think in the 80s or 90s. And that's a rich archive of hundreds of tear sheets that McHale Cordell McHale collected, and it'd be very interesting to know more about what that relationship was, in fact, around the collecting of that material. And the other archives that I've used are the Archigram Group's archives, which were private until very recently, and have now gone to Hong Kong, but are largely available online. At least a lot of the drawings and photographs are available online. But I think what's really interesting and a challenge, particularly when you're dealing with clippings, is that they're often not really that visible within the archive. They tend to be sort of tucked away in one file. And so, and certainly with a lot of the online availability of archives, that's the last material that's going to get digitized. So I think it's a complex question about how one thinks through the status of this material within, let's say, the larger composition of an artist or architect's archive, which would tend to privilege their authorial documents rather than the things that they collected.
Okay, well, I've got two more questions. We haven't got much time left. And I think what I'll do is just, they're mostly for Ben. And Ben, if you could just sort of perhaps, you know, do fairly brief responses, because we've only got, you know, a few minutes. So the first question is about the work on anger. This is from Emma Sharples. Did you find, interesting, any intersections between your thoughts on collage and on the occult? a lot of the material culture of post-war occultism seems oriented towards both collage and the archive. So I suppose that's just a question around how the occult comes into some of the material you've been looking at. And the second question is, could you, Ben, talk a little bit more about how Craig's recovery of the clipping bureau's modes of visual scanning might be applied to some of the practices that you've been looking at? I suppose we could do it the other way around too, but we haven't got time. So Ben, as I say, just a
brief,
kind of brief thoughts, and then we'll have to draw this to a close. We might be able to come back to it in the final panel.
Occult, I was interested to bring in anger for that very reason and that very idea of kind of the occulting. I'll be honest, I haven't thought about it enough. And was it Gemma who posed that question? I think you probably would know more about it than me. What I would say is that if we think about that, there's a kind of occulting as well, a kind of weird quality of sort of magic around collaging that Burroughs is also kind of engaged with, this idea that you can put things together and read across them something which isn't quite there. So there is something kind of and actually I was thinking about David's introductory presentation yesterday. We were talking about the mournful and the eulogy. You know, there is something about ghosts here, and it should be noted that a lot of the collages are being made out of things that are not just immediate contemporary imagery, but Victoriana and all sorts of stuff. And there's definitely this kind of idea of playing with ghosts. On the clippings thing, I'd have to think about it. I mean, I think what Craig's pointed to is something that I completely and really neglected because of what I was looking at, but I think is so important, which is about labor and about work and about what labor and work is valued. And that point that Craig just made about the difficulty of finding clippings, in a way of difficulty of finding source material in archives, because it's not necessarily prioritized in terms of what we understand to be original work, I think is another way of also saying that we find it hard to value perhaps what we might call kind of information work, which is this kind of this work of trawling and looking, and that as looking as a practice becomes a kind of very interesting but much greatly underexplored question, you know. And what do we do with that today, you know, when attention economy, Instagrammers work, you know, the practice of what sort of labor is that? And I think that throws up a really interesting question. That would be my, yeah.
That's great, thank you. I think all I can say is thank you both again so much for these really interesting papers. We might be, I think we can come back to some of these. I think we've just touched the surface of these questions, and we can come back to it at the end of the second panel. We're going to take a 5-minute break now till 1:15. And so just a comfort break, and then we'll start with the second panel. So thank you, everyone. Thank you, speakers, and thank you for your questions.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for taking the speediest of comfort breaks. And we are going to carry on with the second panel, make sure we can hear the papers and fit in as much discussion as we can. As we saw in that first panel, so many ideas are being generated, and we want to make sure that we give them space and that we can have some dialogue between all the panelists too. So I am going to hand over to our next chair for this session, and that is Dawn Ades, who is Professor Emerita of the History and Theory of Art at the University of Essex, and also Professor of the History of Art at the Royal Academy. You can find Dawn's full biography on the events page for this website, but many of you will be very familiar with her work. We're having a bit of feedback issues there, hopefully that's sorted out now, on Dada and Surrealism, and also publications on photo montage, and those ideas are particularly apposite for this session today. So Dawn, I'll hand over to you to chair this next session.
Thank you very much, Sarah, and it's been a very exciting process so far. I've learned a great deal about collage. I mean, both wonderful detailed presentations with a lot of new research, and also an extension of the very idea of collage. Yesterday Elizabeth Price was talking about her film, and she was asked about whether she was interested in the Gothic style, and she said she was, but she would never sort of use a Gothic style. What she would like to see was an art history lecture as Gothic. So I quite like that idea of a new sort of juxtaposition. But I will stop there. I just want to say that I think Surrealism has been a kind of ghost haunting this conference so far, and I expect we shall be looking more closely at that question. So I'm now with great pleasure going to introduce my two panelists, the two speakers. Nicola Simpson first. Nicola is a curator and researcher at Norwich University of the Arts, and her research interests are focused on the performative and experiential influence of Zen and Tantric Buddhisms on transnational and transhistorical countercultural art and writing. She is editor of Notes from the Cosmic Typewriter, The Life and Work of Dom Sylvester Houédard, that was in the Occasional Papers 2012, and co-editor of Dom Sylvester Houédard, published by Riding House in 2017. She also organized the exhibition at the Listen Gallery in 2020, which originally should have coincided with this conference, and we would have had the opportunity of actually seeing the Tantric poetries by Houédard at the same time. But never mind, we will now be shown images of them in her talk. And our second speaker is Andrew Hodgson. I'll go straight on and they will then speak back to back. Andrew is author of the monograph, The Postwar Experimental Novel, British and French Fiction, 1945-75, published by Bloomsbury in 2019. Novelesque Mnemic Symbols, Manchester Dostoevsky, one of the 2019, and editor of the Experimental Writing Collections, Paris. And he's currently researching and writing a book-length study of Surrealism and the novel. And he teaches in French and culture studies at the University of London Institute in Paris. So, Nicola, could we start with your presentation?
Yes, of course. Thank you very much, Dawn. Okay, thank you for inviting me here today to give this paper. And as Dawn mentioned, when I was originally invited to give the paper back in March 2020, it did feel very serendipitous to me that the show I'd curated for the Listen Gallery, Dom Sylvester Houédard Tantric Poetries, would have just opened a couple of weeks before, and that I could encourage the attendees of this Tate conference perhaps to go along and participate in the environment poem installed there. Tantra, whether Hindu or Buddhist, is an experiential transmission, and it did seem fortuitous at the time that there might be this possibility of actively engaging with the work in the exhibition, which work was really, most of the work there was unseen for almost 50 years, and especially unknown are the collage poems I'm going to talk about today. So as a replacement to seeing the work in situ as originally planned, all the images I will show now come from that exhibition, Tantric Poetries, under with the kind permission of the Listen Gallery. And I hope that these images do communicate to you some of the color, tactility, and kinetic energy of these poem objects. So Dom Sylvester Houédard, I'm assuming perhaps not many people know him, so I'll just do a little introduction. Dom Sylvester, or DSH as he was known, was a Benedictine monk, artist and poet from Prinish Abbey, best known for the concrete poems or typestracts that he made on his Olivetti Lettre 22 typewriter in the 1960s and 70s. Houédard, with his early contacts with the Tibetan Lamas Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche and Akon Tulka Rinpoche, his autodidactic study of the first Western commentaries to the practice of Tantra, or Vajrayana Buddhism as it is known, and his initiation into the path by the Dalai Lama, was instrumental in acting as a conduit for the transplantation and transmission of this doctrine to the transnational avant-garde artists and poets of the 1960s. Houédard had been interested in the Eastern contemplative traditions and Tibetan music since a small child, and his studies of Zen and Tibetan Buddhism ran parallel with his Catholic theological journey. He saw his Christianity and any practice of Tantric Buddhism as dovetailing into the mystic's journey to knowing his own heart. In one of his first published essays, Heathen Holiness, he outlined what he understood by the Tibetan Tantric Buddhist practices. Tibetan mysticism aims at liberation from all that is unreal. It seeks attainment of a blissful knowledge of ultimate reality. The aids used in Tibet are based on the Tantra, net, web, wovenness, between the inner and outer worlds. Forces and their events, consciousness and its objects, all form a single weave. The Tantrism is the discovery or establishment of inner relationships between the matter and the spirit worlds, between ritual and reality, between mind and the universe, between the microcosm and the macrocosm. Tantra is not unique in asserting this position of ultimate truth as it is understood in Buddhist traditions. What characterizes Tantra is the methods used to experience this truth, that in the experience of non-duality, there is no distinction between the mind in here and the world out there. Houédard in his essays continues, mudra, mantra, and yantra are translations of the inner experience into movement, speech, and pattern. They link inner and outer reality. They perfect the correspondence between the microcosm and macrocosm. In this essay, written before he made any typestrocks or any other poem objects, Houédard established his understanding of the performative reality of Tantra. I am interested in understanding his understanding of these Buddhist contemplative method practices and how they were incorporated into an increasingly performative artistic practice that engaged directly with Tibetan Vajrayana ritual, and locates Houédard as one of the very first Western Tantric artists, if not the very first British artist, to acknowledge that his work may be understood as yantra, mantra, mandala, and mudra, and as such function as an intentional Tantric language that asks questions about reality. Houédard termed the collage poems I'm showing you cosmic dust poems or laminate poems, and which in their very different compositional nature of the typestracts allowed him to engage in the relationship between matter and spirit with the intentionality of pasting together forces, events, consciousness, and objects that weave together his outer and inner realities of the microcosmic and the macrocosmic. This method of working developed in around 1966 and continued alongside his more almost daily ritual of composing typestracts. Small found objects, cut up prose and cut out pictures were pasted onto clear or bright technicolor sheets or transparent plastic. They are very visually different from the precision and the permutational variations of the typestracts and the antric patterns made on his typewriter. However, these laminate poems, I suggest, also engage with tantric practices of transforming the mind and the objects which appear to mind. Through a stochastic and kaleidoscopic juxtaposition of forms, often found in his immediate environment, his methodology consisted of covering one piece of colored plastic in glue, jam, spit, or other bodily fluids to act as an adhesive before layering the visible objects of cut-out letters, words, images, and the found, but also invisible objects, such as the vibrations left behind from mantra recitation, the gestures and mudras of hands at prayer, the sounds of footsteps retreating down the corridor outside his monastic cell at Prinish Abbey. Then another piece of plastic was placed on top. In a wonderfully vivid description of these Mamanet poems in the exhibition Dom Sylvester Houédard, Visual Poachers, at the Victoria and Albert Museum exhibition from 1971, the critic Guy Brett described these cosmic patches as follows. They are concerned with matter in a way the diagram poems cannot be, but matter as signs. Again, on equal terms with words, they keep the form of pages, transparent, flexible pages, sandwiching the stuff of the poem like microscope slides. The words and sounds are found, cut from the great surplus store of newspapers. The overlaid colours of the plastic may suggest warmth or cold, storm, calm, night or day. Words mingled with modest substances like powder, spit, jam, wire, pills or dust, which could be found in any room, influence one another to become carriers of meaning. By creatively reimagining the monk, one of his many trips to London, dressed in his signature black beret and black Polaroid glasses and mingling with the far out and intoxicated crowds in a typical evening at the countercultural club UFO, we can get a sense of the cultural influences of these microscopic slides. For here he encountered the light projections of the colourful liquids and bodily fluids of the artists Mark Boyle and Joan Hill. Their microscope projections of sperm and blood and vomit filling the whole space alongside the music of Soft Machine or the Pink Floyd and the improvised ballet of the exploding galaxy. In fact, many of the laminate poems are portraits of the countercultural figures he met there at the UFO club and at a similar psychedelic events at the Roundhouse. This one here is actually made for John Hopkins, one of the best known figures of swinging London, and his girlfriend, Susie Cream Cheese. But he also made these kind of portrait collages for other members of the Exploding Galaxy and countercultural figures, such as Edward Pope. And here he is at actually a Richard Saltoun show in 2017 with the collage portrait that Houédard made for him called Ant. Houédard was a well-known figure at all these countercultural happenings. And although he never exchanged his monastic cell at Prinish Abbey for a room at 99 Balls Pond Road, the anarchic hippie commune of the galaxy, he did certainly spend time there and counted himself as a member. As David Madala recalled, Dom Sylvester often slept at the Exploding Galaxy when he couldn't get back to Gloucestershire, usually after midnight, around 2 or 3 a.m. The people who were performing as musicians would usually pass by my place to relax. It was an amazing group of people. You would sometimes have Ravi Shankar, Jimi Hendrix, Soft Machine, the Incredible String Band. The galaxy, especially in their reuse of waste and found objects, scrunch, were a defining influence in Houédard's move away from the typewriter. One member, an early member of the galaxy, remembers the dematerialist philosophy of the commune and their repurposing of found objects into the necessary requirements for a simple living space and art practice. The Dalston House epitomised their actively dematerialist philosophy. Partly out of necessity, but mostly out of principle, they recycled and readapted just about everything. They took consumer commercial waste, which they call scrudge, and made personal clothing and decoration with it, as well as serious, playful, temporary and less temporary artworks. What brought them together? That within their own world, they could eliminate materialism almost entirely. This behaviour from a Catholic ordained Benedictine monk, his imbibition and participation in the excesses of a countercultural art scene, is transgressive, dematerialist, deconstructive, and tantric in a manner that recalls the behaviour of historical Vajrayana practitioners such as Drukpa Khulle and later Chogyam Trungpa Rinpoche himself, with his unconventional behaviour and delivery of the crazy wisdom teachings to the American avant-garde. Houédard had a powerful but unorthodox way of engaging with Buddhist doctrines. These works here are part of an embodied tantric practice where all text, all objects, Christmas cracker toys, talcum powder petals, all actions, however seemingly transgressive for an ordained Catholic monk, sex, eating, dancing, and taking drugs, and all bodily fluids, spit, blood, mucus, and semen, are methods for spiritual transformation and transmission. They function as observations of the microcosmic, not just in that they are tantrically weaving together tiny particles of substances such as talcum powder, semen, and dust, but also an invisible world that remains very deliberately invisible. inner forces and energies of the tantric practitioner are manifest and collage, as is the invisible subatomic world of matter and quantum physics, to become carriers of a spiritual meaning within Houédard's Eastern counter space, informed by the Prasangika school of Majjhimaka Buddhism and its distinct philosophical and hermeneutic approach to the Buddhist doctrine of the two truths. In the first exhibition of these works at the Listen in 1967, Houédard curated them playfully alongside some particles of antimatter from Gloucestershire. There are particles of antimatter glued down alongside images of ritual objects and the vibrations made by mantra recitation, the sung nocturnal matins of Benedictine ritual, and the call of birdsong from the Prinish Abbey Gardens. There is a constant play between the mind and the universe, between the interdependent relationship between all phenomena and how these phenomena are momentarily created and destroyed by mind. For Tantra uses methods to create and essentially destroy an ordinary appearance that sees objects as inherently existent outside the mind. This series of work, engaging with the world beyond that of ordinary appearance, could be said to exemplify what Sean Miller has described as the imaginative encounter between Buddhism and quantum theory. Miller describes the rhetorical strategy of parallelism and the imaginative parataxis required in this juxtaposition of ideas from two distinct epistemological domains. These strategies are certainly helpful and useful in reconsidering Houédard's engagement with the subatomic world. As Miller suggests, quantum theory has an inaccessibility as an abstraction that invites imaginative appropriation. He continues, quantum theory promises a corollary to Buddhism pregnant with possibilities, in large part due to the suggestiveness of juxtaposing two imaginary interior spaces, the internal world of the mind within Buddhism and the microcosm imagined as a world internal to the universe itself. It is this possible corollary between Buddhism and science and the imaginative parataxis that can juxtapose the creation and annihilation of objects within the epistemological frameworks of Tibetan Buddhism, the ritual practice of the mandala in particular, and in the discourse of quantum theory, that can be useful in understanding the performative strategies and the imaginary interior spaces created by these cosmic patches and Houédard's intention to exhibit them alongside particles of antimatter. Houédard's interest in using invisible matter and or the inclusion of a cut-up visible vocabulary explores collage as a trans-historical and transnational tantric Buddhist methodology that imputes and then dissolves the existence and meaning of form. Each cosmic dust poem is about the auto-destruction of the cataphatic cosmos, an apophatic claim of not this and not this, but what Houédard called the non-non, the non-conceptual experience of God, or the emptiness at the heart of the contemplative experience. It is termed non-non because although there is negation or a no-thingness, there is still non-conceptual experience. The laminate poems demonstrate the infinite interrelationships between all phenomena across all time and space and how these relationships are created and destroyed by mind. And the cut-up text in these works often act themselves as semantic keys to these processes and purpose. Here on this work, for example, are the words, on the enclosed leaf, our petition to time before the no act of undoing. And another example here, me, not, 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 not. So to conclude today, I want to return briefly to the Don Sylvester Houédard Tantric Poetries exhibition I curated at Listen in 2020. In the gallery space where I exhibited the laminate poems, the focus was on this very trans-historical interpenetration of all forms, the interdependence of and dance between all objects inside the gallery space and all objects outside the gallery. Initially, those changing forms seen through the gallery window, the calls of the primary age children tumbling through the local school gates, the spring trees emerging into leaf on the pavements outside, the intermittent traffic on Bell Street and the grey March London skies beyond, and then beyond and beyond to all phenomena. In hanging together the laminate poems like an assemblage of hallucinogenic prayer flags in the impermanent environment of the exhibition, This gallery space became a transient mandala where the viewer temporarily encounters an installation that activates the microcosmic and the macrocosmic beyond the world of ordinary appearance. To activate this mandala, I felt it was important that these laminate poems were exhibited alongside some extracts from the mantra Drim Ho 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 Pei, just as Houédard had intended in his 1967 exhibition. In this contemporary exhibition, the mantra was printed in the exhibition guide, enabling the viewer to recite it out loud or silently in their head as they participated in this environment poem. This was an instruction to bring the visual, the oral, and the kinetic together in one environment poem that again would place the viewer consciously into the central experience of spiritual transmission. Here, all phenomena are born and return, the macrocosm of the scene gallery space, the attendees, the invigilators, artworks, floorboards, walls, windows, and the microcosm of the unseen vibrations of spoken word and breath, the impermanent thoughts and emotions of the persons present, and the further hidden collisions, appearances, and disappearances of the subatomic quantum world. Okay, thank you.
Yes, thank you very much indeed for that, Nicola. It was a fascinating presentation, and there will be questions, but I wonder if we could go straight on to Andrew now, because we are rather short of time. So, Andrew, are you there?
Hello, I should be here. Am I here? Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, perfect. I'm going to try and share screen. This one. Okay, so, right. Hello, good afternoon. I'd like to begin by thanking the organizers for having me here to speak about transform action and surrealism in Britain in the late 1960s and 1970s. Apologies in advance for the fairly rough archive photos I've used for examples here. A central figure of what I'll talk about today is the bookseller John Lyle, who, despite the various denunciations and conflicts with other British figures, especially Conroy Maddox in particular, or perhaps indeed also due to those conflicts, appears a linchpin in the continuation of surrealism in the geographical space of Britain, from specifically 1967 to 1979, through the organization, curation, writing, and printing of the sort of scrapbook or zine-esque journal, Transform Action, and his DIY publishing house, which continued to bring the texts of Surrealism and Dada into Britain and into English in somewhat irregular fashion over those years. I've been asked before why I keep banging on about a bookseller in Exeter and a fairly obscure zine published in Sidmouth half a century ago. However, I find the sociocultural effects of Lyle, the bookseller, publisher, translator, writer, and indeed collagist, has been somewhat understated. Lyle represents a weird sort of intersection in the avant-garde of the post-war era. Transform Action began life as Transformation and was printed during the expansive Surrealist Art Fair festival he organized, the Exeter Festival of Modern Art, between 24th April and 20th May 1967. The festival itself was a sort of re-aestheticizing collage, rather. There was an exhibition titled The Enchanted Domain with painting and sculpture by Ernst, Miró, Picasso, Magritte, Dali, Klee, Tanguy et al. Films built by Buñuel and Buster Keaton and others were shown. Lectures were given by Roland Penrose, George Melly and others. The first edition of the publication, Transformation, was put together over the course of 5 days. Stefan Themison was a participant, He, along with other experimental novelists, B.S. Johnson and Alan Burns, are referred to in documentation for the festival as the young British surrealists. A draft section of Burns' novel America is included in the issue, and he continued to participate in the subsequent numbers. Also included are Anthony Enshaw in Breakwell and his diary project, and the movement whose play The Labyrinth was performed at the festival and whose Viva la Muerte is also exerted in Transform Action. Also present at the festival was the psychiatric doctor R.D. Lang of LSD experiment fame, who, similar to Jean de Buffet in France, curated an exhibition of degenerate artworks by psychiatric patients titled Psychopathology and Art. Later inclusions in Transform Action include new writers from across Europe and America, including elsewhere unpublished work by the US writer Ted Jones on what he calls Black Surrealism in 1970s America. This draws the projects of the festival, Transform Action, the tenets of surrealism itself, into a space we might not normally critically equate it to. Out of those interwar years of its sort of regarded heyday, and into new aesthetic and historical contexts, firmly into the post-Second World War era and the attendant new aesthetic experimentations in art and literature that era provides space for. So the first issue, that first issue of Transform Action, then Transformation, also includes work by E.L.T. Messens, who co-edited the first four issues, and Jacques Brunius, who had come to Britain in the 1930s with the intention of guiding the formation of a surrealist movement there. Both Messens and Brunius took a role in putting together the Exeter Festival. According to Lyle, Brunius received André Breton's assent before his death in 1966 for continuing a sort of sovereign strain of surrealism in Britain. And that continuity surrealism, we might say, began with the festival in 1967. Unfortunately, it was actually at the festival that Brunius himself died, as recounted in Transform Action 2 in 1968, I quote, "For Jacques Brunius, it was a new beginning. Exhausted and isolated by anxiety and illness, though he was, he devoted his attention to stimulating the surrealist activity in the belief that Britain, at last, would now be able to assemble a group who would understand the surrealist objectives and who would owe nothing to rank, capital, God, or ancestors. He arrived in Exeter happier than he had been for many months, ready for the opening of the festival the following day. At dinner, surrounded by the friends for whom he had been isolated, from whom he was full of wit and optimism. The following morning, as he was preparing to leave to put the finishing touches to the exhibition, he felt tired, lay on his bed, and died. Black with irony, the festival, which proved to be his last work, began, succeeded, and led, as he had hoped it would, to the beginnings of a surrealist group. So after failing to form a cogent movement in Britain in the 1930s and announcing the discontinuation of that effort in 1947 due to the claimed inherent surrealism within British societal character that prevented the formation of coherent groupings, 20 years later, the iron here is perceived to be ready to be struck. As documentation for the festival in the first issue of Transformation, Transformation reads, "These figures of different groups and generations brought together here perceived there was it was once again the time to seek open conflict with closed rationalism, which was bringing about the death of the word. Without wasting any more time, surrealism now." Which draws this intersectional figure of Lyle into a before, alongside Messens and Brunius, Conroy Maddox, Ethel Colquhoun, and Leonora Carrington. These figures are stated as contributors to Transform Action, or perhaps co-opted rather. And Roland Penrose continued to contribute throughout the life of the journal. Transform Action takes on a sort of pastiche quality in this sense, mixing new writing and artwork by an array of figures alongside old work, letters, and unpublished tracts, all in barely legible mimeographed print, including handwriting. They do not present as anything aesthetically similar to the polished and somewhat sober artifacts of pre-war surrealist revolution as such, but rather a curated space of myriad strains of surrealism across spatio-temporal bounds or limits, drawing plethora of surrealist writings into the historical context of their publication. May 68, attacks on the British Film Institute and the Arts Council, referred with disgust as the neo-subsidiar, Enoch Powell and Rivers of Blood. As artifacts, they take on the sense of perpetually reinventing, re-aestheticizing surrealism for their native moment of production, communication, and reception of meaning. The handwriting, typewriter print, scrolls and scribbles, reproductions of newspaper copy, drawings and photographs give off this sort of frisson or movement on the page as they barely coalesce together, leaving a halo of static or noise around where they've been cut and pasted to be made camera ready for the cheap lithograph printing or ran through the ditto machine and stapled together. Transform action is the product essentially of cheap access to office supplies. It is for this frenetic sort of quality I have, for entirely ahistorical reasons, called this paper Xeroxing Surrealism. Although the process is perhaps also similar to building Christmas lists from the Argos catalog back in the 90s, if you were a child then. Lyle's essay on what he saw as pressing essays on what he saw as pressing issues at the time of publication of each of the 10 issues of Transform Action are jumbled together with quotes, aphorisms, poems, scribbles, and artwork that he presents as pertinent to networking these social concerns into the culture of surrealist thought and aesthetic. This was a process of cutting, pasting, copying, stenciling, typing, amending, that is more in common with late 20th century zine culture that flourished with the advent of the Xerox photocopier and had a similar degraded, noisy, chaotic sort of character that itself becomes a sort of framework for reading and viewing of what that zine or this publication here presents. This idea of later realignments or re-aestheticizations of earlier surrealist work was not singular to Transform Action. The Chicago Surrealist Group similarly performed this practice. For example, in a 1998 edition of the journal Race Traitor, Franklin Rosemont redeployed the long dead French surrealist writer René Clavel's work from the early 1930s to declare a surrealist revolution against whiteness in America. Emerging in 1957, a further late surrealist group, the Tendance Populaire Surrealiste in France, led by Mirabel d'Or, Maurice Rapin, and despite his death in 1967, René Magritte's editorial direction and material input for their publications continued into the 1970s. When speaking of collaging surrealism, Transform Action, therefore, was not alone. And these groups were not isolated. The Tendance Populaire Surrealiste sent their roughly mimeographed parcel sort of publications to Lyle in sincere homage throughout the 1970s. The more anarchist-aligned Rosemonts, alongside Maddox and others, signed their names to No Surrealism in 1971, what the Met Museum in New York describes as a diatribe against the English bookseller John Lyle. In that diatribe, they denounced Transform Action in the following words, I quote, "Lyle's menu offers only a leftover stew of insufferable nostalgia, self-satisfied slogans, vainglorious posturing, pompous rhetoric, and a theoretical incoherence of staggering proportions." Now, it's exactly the stew-like quality to Transform Action, and indeed these other late surrealist publications, that draws my interest. While featuring new writing and art, Transform Action was also frequently jigsaws in much older writing by older figures like Philippe Supot and Louis Cutenaire. It also does so with dead figures like Breton, Jacques Brunius, E.L.T. Messens, and indeed René Magritte alongside Andrew Marvell and Alfred Jarry, all of whom, whether aware or not, or able to be aware or not, are referred to as actively offering their contributions to the publication. This is a very different form of make it new to the claims and practices of earlier avant-garde groups and figures. It presents both a sense of continuation and departure. While the pre-war movement at times displayed a fairly fashionable strain of Marxist political engagement, for example, with the counter-colonial exhibition in 1931, its tendency in this sense was to performance and display, to an aesthetic violence that is mirrored in its shallow rhetoric. As the famous equation of surrealism in the Second Manifesto in 1930, to going down into the street with a revolver and shooting passers-by at random suggests. And yet, as Jean-Paul Sartre states in 1947, the sheer total violence of the Second World War itself killed the poetic political experiments of surrealism. In his words, surrealism was a pretty candy too quickly sucked. And it was in, and this is in response to the 1947 exhibition where the British group itself disbanded. Breton himself, in preface to the reprint of the Second Manifesto in 1947, begs the reader to appreciate his hasty remarks for what they were in their context. And by 1953, he himself writes of surrealism in the past tense. So as referenced in the shifting pastiche aesthetic of transformation, the reader is presented with a potentiality by which surrealism might continue beyond this historico-aesthetic death. And that is in the pursuit of a surrealist socio-aesthetics. The passers-by in the street are no longer there to be performatively shocked, but engaged with, convinced. I quote, "The starving will not be fed by our postures of violent revolution, but by our refusal to exploit them. The blacks in the USA are not helped by the comfortable dwellers in Hampstead, piously shouting slogans and provoking policemen. This belittles their suffering, which is of a kind we can't fully comprehend, whatever we claim. They will be helped only when we, men and women, liberate ourselves from superstition and from greed, muttering time-worn revolutionary mantras, quoting heroes, boasting of our enlightened sympathies, repeatedly and publicly registering ourselves on the side of the angels, striking postures, however violent or aggressively non-violent. All these things are at best not enough, and at worst mere alibis." This unsigned essay from Transformation concludes that we should try to live with less. I quote, "Perhaps then the desperate of the earth will believe in our good faith and welcome our participation." The interests of the artwork itself shifts from political abstractions, dogmatic maxims about revolvers, to the practical process of quotidian oppression in British and wider global society. Surrealist aesthetics become very much more Fabian in concern. a heuristic process. As the following passage reads, that might remind of the context we find ourselves in Britain today, I quote, "There are signs of a possible right-wing tyranny in this country, given a failure in the economy to which we are all tied like martyrs to the wheel, and a despised Labour government replaced by a massively conservative one controlled by its extreme right wing. The only cause in which British workers have come out on the streets in the last 20 years has been that of Enoch Powell. Labour will lose its traditional seats to candidates preaching race hatred. The small freedoms of which we boast when comparing ourselves to foreigners so favourably will be eggs in the hands of a blind juggler." It is in this sense the artifacts of Transformation, both in content and form, themselves create a new aesthetics of surrealism, a sort of sieve of its contemporary societal moment, of which slithers of surrealist texts, new and old, make a sort of patchwork, a collage, for approaching the social context of its contemporary moment. And I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Andrew, and thank you too to Nicola. Not an easy job, really, to bring these two papers together, because one is so much about an extremely, you know, specific, rather isolated individual. And then you, Andrew, were addressing the possibilities and failures of collective action and the problems of post-war surrealism. I thought that last quote you had, I'm not sure what date that was, about Enoch Powell, was that sort of, what date was that, 60?
Off the top of my head, I think it's from the 1968, it's just after Rivers of Blood.
That's right, and I mean, extraordinarily pertinent to where we are today. I mean, it really, yes. It really could have been written about right now in the Conservative Party conference. I mean, one could obviously spend a great deal of time talking about surrealism and about what, you know, the extent to which it is, you know, still very much alive in many places, but has been declared dead so many times. I think the 1947 English group declaration that you quote from the catalogue of the French, big French exhibition, it was a kind of declaration of disbanding the group, but the group was hardly a group as it was. I mean, it was almost more a statement of faith in the continuation of surrealism, which, as they say, was the only international movement not to be subordinated to politics nor sterilized by purely intellectual attitudes. So I think that there's still, you know, something important there, but obviously collage, as our main theme and point, was at the very core, in a way, of surrealism's the question of the real, of reality and of surreality. And I thought we might perhaps start by just a very general question to both of you, to you and to Nicola, to say a little bit more about this philosophical conundrum of what in each case was meant by the real. Nicola, would you like to start? You need to unmute.
Sorry, apologies. So I think what is always difficult unpacking Dom Sylvester's work is because his work is actually so intricately engaged really with a very specific Buddhist school of thought, the Prasenzika Madhyamika school of what's real and what's unreal, within the philosophy of Buddhism and Buddhist thought and emptiness. And the work is always very playful with that. It's always playful with what is seen in one sense as a conventional reality, the object that people experience through their senses, and how that is created through mind as well. And the what Dom Sylvester and obviously the Buddhist schools call the ultimate reality, that experience of reality beyond the experience of any of the sense objects that we encounter through the mind. So, obviously, that is that, I suppose when I was talking a little bit maybe about that quantum theory, it was that sense of, to accept the fact there may be particles of cosmic matter or antimatter from Gloucestershire in one of these kind of visual microscopic slides, that you poem slides you can see from both sides, or the traces of mantra recitation, or all of these things that we cannot see, involves this kind of huge imaginative leap. And it's that sense of that imaginative leap, that the imagination creates reality, which is really at the heart of Tantric Buddhism. So reality really is the imagination in those works and within those Buddhist philosophers. I don't want to go on. I'd quite like to hear more about surrealism, actually, so I'm going to let Andrew talk.
Okay. well, I think in a lot of the kind of things I've been looking at, this included, there is this question after the Second World War, like Sartre himself says something very interesting, you know, you can make art about incendiary bombs, however incendiary bombs themselves will destroy, you know, you and the artwork about incendiary bombs altogether. And this idea of mediating the new realities of a post-war world in this much more, as I kind of referred to it in as a sort of more Fabian concern here, is this idea of, I think, of trying to meet the idea that, meet the kind of brokenness of reality in a sort of, in what might be termed a sort of constructive or productive way, if reality has become incoherent due to the violence of the mid-20th century, then the work that would respond to that or try to mediate that would similarly become formally incoherent. However, I think John Lyle himself was a very isolated figure for most of the work that he did. You know, he was sort of a bookseller on his own with the Rosemonts in Chicago sort of telling him off. you know, he was sort of, his process after E.L.T. Messon and Jacques Brunius were gone, was very much, he had this huge collection of surrealist work. And he would translate it himself. He would cut bits out. He would create these collage, transform action itself, these sort of collages. And in doing so, sort of re-aestheticize earlier surrealist writing and artwork that perhaps no longer could have been perceived as no longer functioning in a social capacity it might have claimed before. And I think this sort of engagement with reality, with the real of the post-war, is itself perhaps a sort of mediation that that time demanded.
Thank you very much. There is a question we have here, which is specifically for you, Andrew. We have two questions, actually, one for Andrew. Andrew, can you talk more about how transform action operated in dialogue with or contributed to the strains of surrealism found in the British underground press of the period, magazines like Oz and IT?
Well, I mean, this is the beginning of a sort of the research really into this part of like the book that will come later. As I say, John Lyell himself became very isolated later on. Looking through what I can access of his, so he had a very, very large archive. And after he died, I think 10, 15 years ago now, that archive sort of went into the wind, sort of. It was sold on online auction sites and it crops up on Abe books and stuff like that. So trying to rebuild his connections with these other presences, it's sort of this like internet Google detective work. And you find these kind of like notes written on things on Abe books or on these auction websites. He had a productive interaction with the Tendance Populaire Surrealiste in France. And as I say, he had this sort of like this ongoing arguments with the Chicago group, specifically via Maddox, who felt that Lyell had sort of frozen him out. And the Chicago group wrote sort of attacks on him, and he wrote attacks back. So he refers to here, this is a sort of pullout from I think the third copy of Transform Action called A New Pope at Avignon, or Laurel and Hardy Slay the Dragon, which is an attack on the Rosemonts and Maddox, sort of saying Maddox is sort of a desperate fanboy of Lyell. That's why he's so obsessed with him. But yes, he did have productive interactions, constructive interactions with others, but then others not so much.
That's true. It's particularly interesting. I'm sorry, I mustn't go on because we could talk about this forever, but it's very, very interesting that Ted Jones contributed to Transform Action, because I think he was a very important figure in moving between the US and France and to an extent the UK.
Most definitely. His work is also in the copy of Race Traitor that I referred to. Mm-hmm.
Well, and he definitely self-identified as a surrealist, as well as jazz musician. I have a couple of questions for Nicola. Nicola, you're very invested in the kinds of spiritual belief propagated by Houédard. Doesn't this make it difficult to maintain a critical or art historical distance on your part? How do you avoid simply describing and celebrating the work?
Yes, hands up, I am a tantric practitioner of 25, 26 years with the Prasenzi Madhyamaka School of Tibetan Buddhism. However, I think this notion of propagation, that these are ideas propagated in the work, is slightly different. I'd like to try and say, perhaps like I've titled my talk, A Talk and Transmission of the Poem Objects. In one sense, it could be seen to be describing them, but I think I'm trying to align it a little bit more with this notion of transmission, the notion of spiritual transmission through that Houédard felt himself was a conduit for to many countercultural artists, and allowing that really to open up the space in how critically you can engage with the work and curatorially in a notion of transmission. It isn't just, there isn't a sense of just describing this engagement of Dom Sylvester with particular tantric disciplines and theories and ideas, but that itself, that notion of transmission, that these ideas have an experiential presence themselves that can be then opened up in critical and curatorial dialogue, I think. So yeah, I feel my part, the fact that I am a tantric practitioner very much actually is important to my approach to the work in that sense.
Yes, very, very interesting. I think there are a lot of fascinating questions about exhibiting, showing curatorial practices that we could go into here. But perhaps this is the moment to open up to the whole panel, to all those who've contributed. Is that right, Sarah?
That's great. Thank you, Dawn. Yeah, it's a good moment to bring sort of all the team back on screen. And I think as Sean has just put in the chat as well, we realise people have probably got things to run off to. We will just take a few more minutes to kind of bring some of these ideas together. And if you have to leave, the recording of the whole session will be available. So you can kind of catch up if you do have to log off now. And yeah, I think it's always when we've had such wide ranging papers and such a richness of debates, it's obviously, this is not a moment to conclude, but perhaps tease out some of the threads. And I think they will get picked up in future sessions as well. I think one of the things that really stuck out for me, and it sort of relates to a comment, Dawn, that you made about surrealism haunting the panel, was about historical framings of collage. And obviously, as a conference, we as conveners, and I would just want to point out fellow co-conveners here, Eleanor Cripper from Tate and Rosie Ram from the Royal College of Art. Obviously, this conference has been shaped as a 1945 to now, or placed within that framework. So with a post-war through the 20th century lens. But I think it is interesting to think about the prehistories or the longer connections, and Lynn, even to your work in the 19th century and the Victorian also seems to haunt a lot of collage work of the 1940s onwards as well. So I wondered whether any of the panelists had other thoughts about the sort of historicization of collage and perhaps some problems with framing it within a sort of post-war culture. That was just one thing that really leapt out at me from all of the talks as well. So I don't know if anyone wants to jump in there. Lynn, will you?
I'll jump in just because that's something that was going through my mind as well, listening to the first panel and also to this panel, because clearly the now or the contemporary and temporality are really crucial, and they're kind of played with in and through collage. But I was also thinking, I think Dawn mentioned the Gothic, and I think there's something about Victorianism and the Gothic and the occult that seems to be weaving in and out of this as a kind of disturbance as well. And actually the characters who have come to my mind, and I apologize, this is just my own work and where I am at the moment, Jane Mansfield and Anton LaVey, who was the high priest of the Church of Satan, and with whom Jane Mansfield had a relationship at the very end of her life. But I was just thinking that the newspaper reports about their relationship, which were very sensational, often had that kind of collage, scrap, clippings look to them. So I think there is a kind of current, it's not even an undercurrent, of something residual, something old, and something irrational that is very important to a lot of the aesthetics that people have been discussing this morning or this afternoon.
Yes, I just very quickly say that one of the names that has kept coming into my mind as people have been speaking, with strange little observations, and that is Alfred Jarry. And it seemed to me that there is a Jarry presence in the post-war period, not necessarily, well, obviously through pataphysics, but I would like to know how broadly, as it were, anyone else has come across that those sort of references to Jarry. And I wonder whether there's a Reyner Banham essay that one of you mentioned. I think it was Craig, wasn't it, which involves a cyclist. And I was thinking of the Jarry essay on the Passion conceived as a bicycle, uphill bicycle race, and wonder whether any of the kind of, you know, the irrationality and nonsense, if you like, but also extremely pertinent point of that could have been part of the idea, and the ideas that Banham was playing with.
Craig, do you want to come in there?
Sure, I think that might've been Ben who mentioned that essay on the atavism of the mini cyclist, but no, I think it's a really intriguing line. I know that in the architecture circles that I have been looking at, the French group in particular, the Utopie group, they were very much interested in the legacy of Jarry, and Jean Baudrillard was himself a member of the Collège du Pataphysique. And so there was a degree to which thinking about technology was inflected with a kind of pataphysical sensibility, hinging on the absurd, absolutely, yeah.
In terms of transformation, it's full of representations of the pataphysical spiral and ubu, and it's very much sort of like weaved in. There's a pataphysics kind of weaved into it very, very deeply. I mean, some of the people that contributed to it were indeed members of the college.
I mean, just to say quickly on the atavism essay, I mean, I think it's kind of, I mean, it's like anything with Banham, there's a lot of humor in it, and play that in itself is kind of purposefully sort of non-earnest. But I guess the atavism of the short distance mini cyclist, you know, is a kind of bit of, as well, of a sort of fingers up in multiple directions, one of which being kind of angry young men, you know, and loneliness, the long distance runner, and kind of a, I guess, a sort of sense that maybe some of the interest in kind of playfulness and style was a little bit to the side of some of the more kind of earnest and serious, I guess, sort of socio commentary of the time. But also, I think atavism itself, you know, there was such a sense that what was being displaced at the early ICA was a kind of Jungian interest in archetype and the universal, in a way that I think there's also a kind of critique of an idea of the atavistic. I don't think one could say that there was necessarily a kind of conscious critique of the problems of atavism in its relation to primitivism and colonialism, but I think there was a kind of implied critique of some of those elements that some of the pre-war surrealist affiliations maybe had with a kind of more deep-rooted Jungian understanding of atavism and archetype. But that's just my kind of take on it.
Thank you, and I think it will be interesting to reflect when we've heard all the panels about these these moments of disturbance or haunting of different periods and modes, and the reappearance or the revenants as well being evoked through certain practices and images. Just another point that sort of for me came across through listening and watching actually all the panels, thinking about these Zoom webinars as a viewing experience as well, and was a point that I think quite a few of you touched on about the experience of viewing collage or interacting with it as not just as physical objects. And I think in a way, sometimes taking us away from thinking about these things as physical objects to thinking of the artwork or the work as experience or an environment. And I think, Nicola, your paper sort of made us think about that in particular, and how then these things are displayed in their afterlives. Or Ben, your comment that you made about, you know, you can walk through an exhibition backwards, or you can go through a magazine the wrong way as well, and taking us sort of into the realm of viewing and encounter and using these works as well. And I thought that was just, again, it's a different framing of the material, which I felt connected across the panel. And I don't know whether anyone has further thoughts, or Rosie, Eleanor as well, whether you wanted to come in here and make any comments.
No, I thought what you're just saying was really interesting in terms of, I think, and seeing Nicola, your show at the Listen Gallery as well, as thinking about the curatorial presentation of these kind of practices today, and how we, whether we encounter them through the digital or whether we encounter them within exhibition spaces, and even, you know, thinking about how we might encounter transform action today. Andrew was talking about, you know, finding some of these archives online, and yeah, I suppose it speaks to your question, Sarah, about the, and even earlier when we were talking about the kind of the sort of spatial, when our engagement with collage is kind of spatialized, how that is very different to a collage practice that kind of consolidates something into a single material form. And I think these papers that we had over the course of today have really spoken to that. You know, when we're thinking about text or turning pages, or thinking about kind of get collections of clippings, it's like the kind of aggregation of these materials, what that does to our understanding of the relationships between them.
sorry, is there time for me to
say something? Yeah, do that too.
Okay. This is a really interesting point for approaching something like transform action, where all of the documentation was there for the festival and for everything, but then it was dispersed beyond our ability to kind of like to access that now. So all we have are, you know, especially for the festival, the vast majority of the documentation that we have, that we might have for that, unless we can find wherever that documentation has been sold to, are photographs from the auction website, which are these little clippings, like, you know, these little clip kind of photographs of different documents, and trying to rebuild an image from that. And it's this, yes, this, it's sort of like the materialized sort of snippet view from Google Books, really. And that has an effect on how we interpret the historical record, art and literary historical record. There was a question earlier about publications and John Lau's interactions with them. And, you know, at present, I have not seen the documentation to say how he did interact with those. However, I have seen it for this, this, and this. Therefore, that definitely guides focus in that respect.
I mean, just very, very quickly, I mean, it was a great tragedy that John's archive went, and there were many attempts to save it. But as with Breton's collection that was dispersed, there's an institutional dislike of people like John Lyle and Breton of surrealism. I mean, it doesn't actually quite fit with the, you know, official cultural policies, and you know, no, it was not possible to organize anything to save it, but it was a great tragedy. I mean, he had an enormous collection of, obviously, of, you know, all the material behind Transform Action, as well as a great book collection. Yes, and there were many other little publications that he made at the same time, like Blue Food, which I expect you. Yes.
Yes. In No Surrealism, they call it, can't remember what they call it now, something, some petty side project or whatever. Right.
Great. Yes. Well, I think in view of time, we will draw things to a close for today, but we hope that our panelists and the audience who have logged on will join us again tomorrow, or when you can, or come back and look at the recordings for this conference. I want to thank all our panelists, Ben, Craig, Andrew, Nicola, and our two chairs, Lynn and Dawn, for bringing together such a rich conversation. And I think we can see from the chat how people have really engaged with your idea. There's probably, you've been concentrating on your talk, and you've not been able to perhaps always see that people have been really responding and thanking you for really great papers, and for prompting so many, many more questions, and that we hope will continue over the next few sessions. So do join us tomorrow at 12 o'clock, when we have another session, which is called Collage as Method, Manuscript and Moving Image. stage, and that will consist of a keynote by Claire Zimmerman, which is chaired by Victoria Walsh, and we'll also have an artist presentation led by Judah Attil. So I hope you'll be able to join us then, and join me with a very loud virtual round of applause for all our panelists today. Thank you so much, everyone.